This week at the Internet Cafe, the hacker culture. Are they demons or saviors? Would you trust your files to this man? What is the cult of the dead cow? And why don't these guys use their real names? Plus free software, a cyber blast of 4 megabytes of cool stuff if you've got a TV modem. Hackers tonight at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. For connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stuart Chaffee. I'd like to meet my friends Jane and Andrew. And we're here at a cyber cafe in San Francisco called CoffeeNet, and we're talking about hackers tonight. We're going to meet some hackers tonight, and it's kind of timely because we just read that some hackers got into the CIA's website. So it makes you really wonder if it's easy to break into and alter the homepage that's run by the Central Intelligence Agency. How safe is your company's website, your personal website, personal information that's out there on the net, your credit card, and that kind of stuff? It's kind of scary.
It really is. And you know, it was interesting for me when we were going to all the websites and looking at all the things, especially that CIA website. Is really trying to get an understanding of what's making these guys tick. Why are they doing what they're doing? I mean, is it really about a political agenda and freedom of information, or are these guys just having fun?
Right.
I'm also excited because we're going to talk not only to hackers but to corporate security network experts, and these are guys who spend their days trying to keep hackers out of their networks. And we're going to look at some of the tools that they have developed to catch hackers, and also see how hackers may be using those same tools themselves to get into systems.
And same time, the same guy is a hacker and he's a corporate security consultant at the same time. All right, we in fact are going to meet some of the most notorious, infamous hackers in the world tonight, and we're going to visit some very weird websites where the hackers hang out.
We're here with Dan Farmer, who is a corporate network security expert and has been a consultant for many large computer companies. And we're going to talk a little bit about what network security means. I'm just curious how you got started in the security business.
Well, back in 89, which is kind of like the Stone Ages on the internet.
A long time ago. Long time ago. In your teens, I take it.
Not quite. I wish it were. But I was actually finishing up school. I was kind of programming and going to school half time. And I was one credit short of graduation, so I took a summer class and wrote a program called COPS.
Now, did you finish school? I have to ask.
I finished school. Yes.
Okay,
I got
good.
My bachelor's,
major
my
parents
piece of paper.
Great.
And
what did COPS do?
Well, COPS was a security audit program. It basically diagnosed a Unix computer and told you what was wrong or right about the system.
Great.
And I gave it away, attracted some interest in industry and government, and got a call from CERT, which is the Computer Emergency Response Team, to get a job out in Carnegie Mellon.
Now, is CERT a government agency?
No, CERT was a federally funded research company.
Okay.
And essentially they would get government money, but they were free to do research or whatever they wanted with. They were actually part of a larger organization called the Software Engineering Institute.
Okay, great. So tell me kind of what the average day would be like for a corporate network security person.
Well, you know, I don't really know what an average day
okay,
is.
What would be an exciting day, a day that would just really get your blood flowing?
Well, there's good days and bad days.
Okay.
And a bad day might be that you get a page or a phone call at 3 a.m. and someone says that, you know, someone just broken into our main corporate computers, and what are you going to do about it? You know, save the day, and then you have to scramble around looking for, trying to track down intruders. Or
great. Now, what do you usually use to track down intruders? Are there software tools that you're using, or?
Well, it's kind of like this little combat you have with the enemy, so to speak, and you use the same kind of tools that they're using to try to track them down. While they're trying, a little cat and mouse game, while they're trying to run away from you, you're trying to chase them. Sometimes vice versa. If you're trying to sneak up on them, sometimes they turn on you and attack you. But usually, since you know the computers better, you have hopefully a better knowledge of your systems. You can kick them off or try to get them out.
Last year, you were involved in releasing a software program on the internet called Satan. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. Well, Satan was an acronym. It's a security administrator tool for analyzing networks.
Okay.
And kind of like the name sounds, it was a tool that you could point at points on the network, machines on the network, anywhere in the world, actually, from wherever you were, and you could analyze the security of the systems, and it could tell you if they're vulnerable, if they could be broken into with a very easy-to-use graphical interface.
Great. Now, I understand there was a lot of controversy about this because you released it free on the Internet, so
yeah.
It wasn't just available for network folks. It was also available, I guess, for hackers as well.
That's right. My co-author, Vitsa Venema, and myself are both very big on education and giving information about security to people. Part of the problems we had with a lot of the security world is people like to keep tight to their chest all the secrets because they think if you know about some way of breaking the system, they'll be in trouble.
Right.
But we thought that the tool would actually help out people because they could then know how to defend themselves. And as it turned out, with all the press and the furor and everything, people actually focused on security and tightened up their systems, and I would hope use the tool to for good use.
So you didn't hear of any hackers that used it to get into, you know?
Yeah, almost none at all. There was so much hype before. I think everyone was so afraid that they all fixed their machines before that.
Right. That's good. Now, what about that hype? It seems like there was a little bit of an unorthodox way that you released this program.
Well,
I mean, first the name, Satan. Come on.
Yeah. Well, I mean, with any product, the name is, you know, 2/3 of what the value of the product is.
Right.
We wanted to have something. We were a little afraid that if we released it, that people. And we didn't tell people about it, that people would then blame us for kind of sneaking this hacker tool in the net. And it's not like we planned all the hype. I mean, you can't orchestrate this kind of media machine.
Right.
And
but you did issue a warning in advance, is that correct?
That's right.
Okay.
But it was just, you know, a general net posting saying, look, we're doing this, we're releasing this tool, this is what it does, you know, fairly clear
right.
language.
We and
didn't,
what
we didn't
happened?
Try to incite people, but I don't know, started getting some press from some of the major newspapers, getting on the front page, and all this television started descending on me, and I could barely move without getting hitting a camera. And so, but I think overall the thing was actually a very positive thing because all the press was a positive thing.
Great.
Because it allowed people to, again, get more awareness
right,
of the whole
right.
subject.
What's the next program that you're working on?
Well, it's kind of a technical thing, but essentially it's a way of managing or devising a policy structure for large-scale networks on Unix systems. And
what kind of a name have you given this one?
Undecided as
yet.
Great. Won't be anything quite as flashy, though. I think okay. I've learned my lesson.
Okay, great. Well, thanks.
Greetings from the loft. Current stock tip in the hacker community seems to be dealing with security dynamics of Massachusetts. The makers of Secure ID scrambled the security problems in their one-time password token cards were presented to the net in the form of a white paper from ftp.secnet.com. The stock tip for security dynamics, NASDAQ ticker SDTI, seems to be sell short. With any luck, they will fix their problems in their product, and yet again, we'll have a case of technology progressing due to hackers and security professionals worldwide.
So, Aleph, tell me, what kind of information can we find at underground.org?
On the ground, you can find security papers, security tools, database of security vulnerabilities, links to other security web pages, other hacker homepages, recent news, calendar of security events, information about hacker conferences, some graphics and pictures. So it's quite a large amount of information.
So it sounds like there's almost two worlds that you're playing to, that security side and then the hacker underground,
yeah,
basically.
Yeah, there's a bit of both. There is a need for that. You know, there needs to be an exchange of information between both. And really, the information is neutral. You know, it can either be used for hacking or it can be used for securing. I mean, it's all it is information.
So why did you create underground.org?
Underground just started as my personal homepage. Found a couple of interesting sites on the net I wanted to keep track of that were useful to me. Found some good tools that I like. And people started coming to check my page, and they would send me emails saying how useful it was to them. And just over time, it kept growing until what it is today, and it's been 4 years since then.
So it's pretty exciting. In fact, I checked out some of the places in underground.org, and there were some discussions and stories in the newspapers about various hackers and all
mm-hmm.
of the different things that they did. And thinking about that, I mean, recently we had that break-in with the Swedish hackers getting into the CIA webpage and making some pretty significant changes to that page. And one of the things that they did, Aleph, was put a link to your homepage, underground.org.
Yes.
Any idea why they would have done that?
Well, I think that yes, if you ask anybody on the net where could they find information about security, you know, they'll point you to several websites, and probably one of them would be underground. So I think it was just a statement. You know, they broke into the CIA's website. They showed them they had no security, and, you know, and they're showing them, well, you know, go here to learn something about security.
So you're sure that, you know, you didn't have anything to do with that CIA
No, I'm sure of it, yes. I would remember.
Oh, okay. So, now, another thing, the Department of Justice had the same thing happen to them.
Yes,
they got broken into as well. So, I guess what that says is that these websites are pretty vulnerable.
Yeah. A lot of people are actually, you know, scared. It's like they're wondering, well, is, you know, information that the CIA has in their computers not going to be able to break in, people stealing them. But the CIA has their own network separate of the internet, which is not connected to the net. You would need to get into a dial-up server or actually physically go into their offices and use one of their computers to get all that kind of information. But it's a different picture for all these corporations that are connecting their intranets to the internet. Most of the time, the only thing protecting their network is a firewall. And a firewall is a pretty static thing. You buy it, you install it, and you leave it there, you know. And a month from now or a year from now, a new security problem may arise that the firewall vendor maybe didn't think about. And maybe they'll be vulnerable then.
So the fear is not, you know, make-believe. There really is a serious issue in terms of being able to get through
the
firewall.
Yes, it's also not really, you know, you don't have to be paranoid about it. There's nothing in life that's 100%, and security is obviously not one of them. But it's something that evolves, and it's something that you have to keep up with. You know, you cannot just go up and secure a machine and say, oh, there, it'll be secure
right.
in, you know, a year.
And you should know, because you were one of the hackers getting into that,
well,
that
yes,
place.
Well, yes, we experimented for a while.
So what do you think, what's the psychology behind it? I mean, is it really all about freedom of information and being able to show that
there's, a bit
there's
of
no
everything.
Security out there?
There's a bit of bravado. It's a bit of showing your peers that you can do it. This obviously learning. So there's a bit of everything.
Is it an innocent game or is it, you know, is it serious business?
It starts as an innocent game. Some people may go the wrong way and end up in jail. Some other people, and which is most of the people I know, you know, eventually end up with jobs in corporations doing the same thing they did before, just getting paid for doing it.
So something like what you're doing now,
exactly.
I mean, basically mm-hmm. talking about all those security things. And there's another place at that website, something called Bugtraq. Can you tell
yes,
me a little bit about
Bugtraq
that?
Yes, Bugtraq is a security mailing list I maintain. It's one of the largest security mailing lists on the net. There's probably a few thousand subscribers to it. We have a policy of full disclosure, which means when a new security vulnerability is discovered, we usually publish full details about it. And the reason we do this is because normally when an organization such as CERT, which is federally funded to do such a thing as publish advisories and security vulnerabilities, they do it a very long time after they've been told about the security problem. So for example, somebody would go up to CERT and, you know, tell them, we found a bug. CERT will talk to the vendors, and they'll learn those who know about it, but they'll take several months to publish a solution to the problem. And by this time, the probability is that hackers know about it, and they're out there breaking into machines.
So Bugtraq is kind of almost pushing the vendors
exactly.
to fix by, those problems faster?
By putting fear on their heart,
right.
if you make them publish.
But then the hackers are going to Bugtraq too, so I mean they're finding
yes,
out
of
some
course.
Of those problems and really even pushing the,
well,
the security breakers
yes,
a
I mean,
bit farther.
Yes, I mean, it is a trade-off. You trade off a bit of that security to having the vendors, you know, come up with patches as fast as possible. But if you think about it, most likely the most elite hackers already had the security
so
problems.
Already, they were already there
exactly.
before you guys even
so
got there. So give me some ideas. If I wanted to get information about hacker psychology or, you know, what being a hacker would be all about, or let's say I wanted to understand a little bit more
mm-hmm.
about security, where are some websites that you'd
recommend?
I would
check something like
2600.com,
which is the website of a hacker magazine. I would check things like root.org. Which is a loose need of computer hackers.
Great.
If you wanted to just learn more about general security, I would check something like COAST, the University of Purdue. They have a security department there and they do a lot of research. They keep a large archive of security tools and papers. I would check things like CERT.
Thanks a lot. I really appreciate spending the time and getting a little bit more information about the background on security and hacking.
No problem.
Okay.
Thank you.
On tonight's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you four cool programs. That's right, our Cyber Blast is dumping data so fast that we can send you four complete programs in less than 2 minutes. Now, what you're seeing over here is the actual data coming into your computer right now. We're sending you these programs in the TV signal at about 2 megabytes per minute. If you don't have a TV modem, you can also get these files off of our website on your regular telephone modem. Now, doing it that way will take you at least a half an hour of connection time. But with our super fast CyberCast technology, we're able to do this in less than 2 minutes. Now, let me tell you what we're sending you. First of all, do you think you're a hacker? We're downloading to you the official hacker test. Answer the questions and the program will tell you whether or not you have a right to call yourself a hacker. Now, if you're worried about other hackers, we're also sending you the latest version of Virus Scanner from McAfee. It's been updated to check for 257 new viruses, which have been added since the previous version of the program. Next, we're going to let you hack away at a golf ball. We're downloading Golf Score Analyst. It's a great program for keeping track of all your golf stats and analyzing your strengths and weaknesses. Finally, just for fun, we're sending you Screen Picks by Galtware. This cool utility lets you easily turn any graphics file or files in any format into a screensaver. Remember, we're sending all 4 programs to you in under 2 minutes. Now, to download these files this fast, you do need a TV modem. If you need information on how to use or find a TV modem, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at www.pctv.com. TV modem uses the broad bandwidth of the television signal rather than the limited capacity of a phone line. That's how we're able to send you so much data so quickly. In fact, we're sending this to you at about 1 megabyte every 30 seconds. So it looks like the download is just about complete. Have fun with your 4 new programs. Remember, if you need more information, check out our website. It's www.pctv.com. That wraps up this Cyber Blast of the Internet Cafe. I'm Giles Bateman.
All right, so you guys are members of the Cult of the Dead Cow, kind of a pretty select group. There's about 12 members,
right?
I guess. And this is a website and a group of what, hackers? Do you call yourself a hackers organization?
I think we're primarily hackers that don't hack anymore. We're an electronic zine for the, you know, the hack freak community, people like us.
Okay. Now, why don't you hack anymore?
I think most of us have outgrown it to an extent. We started very early, in the early 80s, when it was really exciting. New and fresh, and these days it just isn't that way anymore.
When you say outgrown, is that because you're older or like the world is different?
I think the world is different. It used to be that one person on his own could exploit or discover features of computer systems that were still in development, things that were constantly renewing themselves. Now both the computer technologies have settled down, and also, you know, it's much more difficult to do something on an individual basis.
So you talk about hackers and freaks. What do you mean by freaks?
Well, freaks are generally people concerned with the phone system, the inner working of the phone system, and the network that comprises that system.
All right, now, so we still hear a lot about hackers. You guys are saying, I mean, it's really not much fun anymore. Is hackers just like a social, cultural, rebellious thing these days? You're not really a hacker, you just call yourself a hacker?
I think it may be that way. I'm sure it's exciting for the kids that are up and coming now, but I don't think they feel nearly what we felt back in the early 80s when it was a whole new world out there.
I mean, what did you feel back in the 80s when you started hacking? What was your motivation? What was the excitement?
It's an entire new world of electronics to explore, you know, and it's something that, it's a world that hadn't been explored by anyone. It was just wide open.
Was it power in a way for a kind of, you know, anxiety-ridden teenager to think, hey, I can break into this thing?
Maybe so, but the rush of discovery is something that you really can't put into words. Today, though, I mean, there isn't much to discover anymore. You can subscribe to 2600 or Blacklisted and get all the information you need. There's not much to find on your own.
So it's just matured kind of too much to really make it difficult for you, I guess. It's not as satisfying.
Not as satisfying, yeah.
Let me talk about your website. I mean, the Cult of the Dead Cal CDC, which is a really interesting website. And the first thing I noticed, you go on there and you spend the first, like, 8 pages bragging about your press clippings. I mean, is this like a big put-on? I mean, you guys just playing with everybody out there and they all think you're terrible guys, but you're just, like, pulling everybody's chain?
Well, I think we are playing with people to an extent, but if you dig past it, you find actual information there. And on the other hand, you know, it's really not about the technical information. You know, we've been promulgating files with fiction and other things, and that's really led to our longevity.
But I mean, most people log on to CDC. I mean, are they looking for hacker technical stuff, or is it really just another e-zine?
I'm really not sure what most people are looking for. I know a lot of people are looking for hacker stuff.
Really?
We get mail, you know, 50, 75 pieces of mail a day from kids who want to join, or they want us to hack their school computer system or whatever, you know.
So I mean, it's a lot of teenage boys basically coming into this and like doing their destructive, malicious kind of thing.
I think it's a lot of them, and it's also an established fan base that we have. The old school people that remember us from back when they came up and have followed us along the way, our friends.
But you say the content on the site, I mean, there's a lot of just good, serious writing in there, right? It has nothing to do with hacking.
Oh, that's true. There's also a lot of spurious, you know, bizarre fiction. But
right.
Yeah, there's all kinds.
Now, there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of four-letter words and a lot of sort of scary, intimidating sort of stuff in there. Is that just, again, just to have fun and play with it? I mean, you sort of trying to scare people off or just titillate them?
I think it's a parody. It's a counterbalance to the rest of the hack world that takes itself way too seriously. That's what it is.
But you're just having fun with folks there.
Yeah.
But there is a serious aspect to it. I mean, you're really getting a message across. When you guys go out there and hack, I mean, aren't you trying to make people aware that the net is really not a secure, safe place, no matter what people say?
Oh, absolutely. I think a lot of companies are trying to sell you on the idea that the internet's completely safe, that you can throw information around as long as it's not a credit card number. That's just not true. There's already too much information available too readily on the net. And, you know, we're trying to point out that anyone can get to it.
Now, hackers and CDC, I mean, you guys have been called terrible things by the media, sickos and evil people of one sort or another. I mean, you guys, I mean, I take it from what you're saying, you don't think of yourselves as bad people, right?
I don't think of myself as a bad person.
But there may be others out there.
Oh, but I think there are plenty of people who are happy with that title, actually.
Because they just like feeling that or because it's accurate?
Both. I'm sure it's both.
In a way, do you guys provide a service, though? I mean, the hacker part of you. In that, I mean, the industry learns stuff from you because there's like odd kind of spy versus spy thing going. I mean, you discover a bug, you discover a hole, which really then helps somebody else solve it, right? So, I mean, are you doing a service by being a hacker in a way?
I think, incidentally, that certainly
you
has
don't mean
happened.
To do it.
We certainly don't mean to do it, but I think security has definitely evolved in the period of time, you know, since we got into hacking,
right.
The last 10 or 12 years. It's a completely different world.
Although we do sponsor HoHoCon every year, our convention in December, and that does a lot to help out the security people. They get to see the kinds of things that hackers have been up to in the last year.
Is that an adversary relationship between the hackers and the security people, or is there sort of a symbiotic relationship?
What we've actually tried to do is get the security people and the hackers together, so the security can see these kids and realize they're just ordinary, interested kids, and not hate them in the same ways that they have, and vice versa, you know? I think we've done some good towards bringing those two sides together a little bit.
Do you think it's unfair, then, the sort of demonization of the hackers in the media? I mean, you say hacker, and most people think bad guy, criminal, crook, breaking into something. But in a way, I think you're really saying, Reed, that the computer industry sort of benefits from the work that hackers do, in a sense.
Well, I think many hackers actually deserve, you know, any demonization that they get. But, you know, by and large, most of the hackers aren't out to destroy the world, you know. If they were, it would have been destroyed by now.
All right, thanks a lot, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, this is Death Veggie, Minister of Propaganda for Cult of the Dead Cow Communications, bringing you our Media Global Domination Update for October 1996. We here at CDC are proud to announce that Operation Mad Cow, as initiated by our British Commando Geneticist team, is a complete success. There are now more dead cows in England than ever before. Our plans are progressing well on schedule, and by this rate, we should be in full control of this measly little planet that you call Earth by the year 2003. Have a nice day.
All right, let's be honest. It's almost 2 o'clock in the morning here in the Internet Cafe. We've spent a lot of time with these hackers tonight, more than the people on TV have seen. I want to ask you, Jen, you were kind of dubious and I think a little uncomfortable about this whole hacker subject when we started. Now that you've spent a lot of time with these guys, what do you think now?
Well, you know, it's really interesting because when we were surfing the sites, you know, we see some things that are a little edgy out there.
Yeah.
And then talking to these guys, it was quite a different experience.
Oh, me, huh?
I wouldn't do anything like that. I'm into security, you know, so it's kind of almost like everybody's having their moms watching the TV. They're kind of
telling
things
maybe
down.
we got a little sort of con. I would say con, but I mean, everybody was like, oh, we're helping the security of the net. But of course, these guys know why they're helping because they know what you can do. Also, I think some of these guys told me kind of off camera, well, when I was 14, 15, 16, and they weren't going to send me to jail, I was doing more hacking.
Right.
And also, they've grown up, frankly. It's sort of like the hippies in the 60s in Chicago at the Democratic Convention. They wear suits and they have real jobs and they have wives and houses and mortgages, and they act differently now.
But these guys didn't get haircuts. Not at, well, Dan didn't search.
That's for sure. He was a great guy. He was really at the forefront of the whole networking and security issues front, had to teach himself, kind of take that hacker mentality and learn what to do on the net. Released this program, Satan, that turned out to be a really popular program that actually helps corporations, you know, keep hackers out.
Yeah, yeah, interesting. One last point I'd like to make on the cult of the dead cows, the guys I spoke to. That's, as you said, very edgy. I mean, there's a lot of four-letter words, bad stuff. But if you get past that, it is a very well-done website. A lot of good content, some of the best writing I've seen on the web. So there's kind of prejudice on the web, too, even though they say there isn't. Hey, thanks for joining us. Get your coffee mug, your TV browser here same time next week, and join us again at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. For connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.